Stanford Police Department.
Hey, we've had some break-ins in my neighborhood, and there's a real suspicious guy. This guy looks like he's up to no good, or he's on drugs or something.
Okay, and this guy, is he white, black, or Hispanic?
He looks black.
Did you see what he was wearing?
Yeah, a dark hoodie, like a gray hoodie, and either jeans or sweatpants and white tennis shoes. He's got something in his hands. I don't know what his deal is.
Okay, just let me know if he does anything, okay? Yeah, we got him on the way. Just let me know if this guy does anything else.
Okay.
Are you following him?
Yeah.
Okay, we don't need you to do that.
These they always get away. Yeah.
I personally got obsessed with watching the Zimmerman trial. I was at a bar, and I knew that the verdict was due because everything went silent. And that's when we started to check our phones.
Please be seated. I understand that we have a verdict.
Circuit Court of the 18th Judicial Circuit in and for Seminole County, Florida, State of Florida versus George Zimmerman. Verdict, we the jury find George Zimmerman not guilty. So say we all, four person.
When I saw that George Zimmerman had been acquitted, I felt like I'd been punched in the gut.
When the George Zimmerman verdict hit, everyone was talking about it. And so you had this loud rise of voices. It almost became the OJ trial of the new century.
Many people were trying to make sense of what happened, but I felt like the ways that people were trying to make sense of what happened and what we needed to be doing about it were actually destructive.
Nobody asked your goddamn opinion. Somebody wants your goddamn opinion. You're an asshole.
How do we learn how to organize? How do we learn how to develop a set of demands that will actually transform conditions in our communities? I wrote a letter to Black people on Facebook saying that there was nothing wrong with us and we deserve dignity and respect.
I came across Alicia's post hours later. I understood there's this thing called a hashtag and you can make something go viral. And then I put a hashtag in front of it saying Black Lives Matter.
The moment was electric. Black Lives Matter was a brilliantly framed set of marching orders slash slogan slash plea. I can't pretend that I saw a movement coming out of this particular moment, but young Black people, they are plugged in and they're moving this conversation. They're driving this conversation.
It was taking off like wildfire, but people are really beginning to ask the question, is this just young people that are playing out on Twitter? And in Facebook, is this legitimate activism or just people using their phone? Is this a moment or a movement?
I did nothing. We sit here the whole time running our business. Every time you see me, you wanna mess with me. I'm tired of it. It stops today.
So guy right here is forcefully trying to lock somebody up for breaking up a fight.
everybody standing here. They told you I didn't do nothing.
Hold on.
No, don't touch me, please. I can't breathe.
Racist on Staten Island. This is what the they do.
The difference between Trayvon Martin and Eric Garner was that here you saw the injustice. There was video associated with it. So not only did you have this description, you also had a black man who was there getting wrestled to the ground by police who was saying, I can't breathe.
There's growing outrage here in New York over the confrontation with police that was caught on cell phone video.
The movement is actually happening and it's connecting the dots. Now we have, instead of this scattered buckshot of black people talking about things that have happened to them, and it's just word of mouth, now it is a hardcore human movement that is crafty enough to use social media to lift up its voice, to have a serious impact and change the direction of the national conversation.
There are people now with phones watching the police. So it's very, very powerful. We want America to see what is happening. At a certain point, we are going to blow. We are going to blow the door down.
I was getting ready for work, and then I heard the first gunshot. I just knew that someone had got shot on the street, and it was by police. It was such a surreal moment. I was kind of just like tweeting really fast. I remember I had a lot of typos. And then people started seeing it.
It was only a few weeks after Eric Garner when it happened. And so there was something about August 9th in Ferguson that really became a catalyst for the eruption of a national movement.
People wanted not just answers, they wanted justice. Things are raw. You're dealing with a young black male, unarmed, shot multiple times. And at that point, the story was that he didn't run, he had his hands up. So you already had a lot of emotion surfacing.
To the officer, I pray for you, because you shall reap what you have sown.
And we are going to drive him to hell.
The police murdered Mike Brown in the middle of the street. And his body was laying down there for 4 hours. People just wanted justice for this dead black boy. But then the police bringing dogs out, pulling guns out on women and kids. Yeah, that's what took the turn.
I remember seeing elderly people out there and children out there. We were being at home, right? Being in our own streets. And for folks in Ferguson, literally their own streets. But we were treated like... We were treated like we were in a war.
If you are in the middle of the street, you're unlawfully assembled. Disperse immediately.
Everything erupted in Ferguson. This is rage. It's profound sadness. And it was all on Twitter.
Social media extended the reach of the activists. It both allowed people in faraway localities to have a minute-by-minute view of what was continuing to happen in Ferguson. And it also meant that activists could communicate immediately about where demonstrations were, where protests were. It just accelerated the rate of activism surrounding this case.
We were out in the streets responding to the needs as they were presented. And in that moment, young people were saying, we're gonna stand up and we're not going home.
I was just there. I wasn't there trying to be the news or be a reporter. I just tweeted everything that I knew to be true. And the next thing you know, like, the police are shooting tear gas. And it was the first time I thought I was gonna die.
Oh, they're coming back.
Go, 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 go.
Ferguson, Missouri is under a state of emergency.
I signed an order declaring a state of emergency.
This is for your safety.
The eyes of the world are watching.
Those visuals impacted my desire to go there, seeing police pulling out, where did you get tanks and full body armor and bazookas and all of this tear gas?
It happened via social media. And you're kind of looking at things and you're kind of like, what just happened? St. Louis is home for me. And I used to live in the same apartment complex where it had happened. So I had to come back for that situation.
We just had a stupid-ass cop.
No, what is that?
And we need to make sure that he pays for what he does.
Ferguson becomes a magnet for activists around the country. The activists who form Black Lives Matter organize a freedom ride to Ferguson, where they bring 500 activists from around the country to demonstrate solidarity.
I was sitting on my couch, it was 1 o'clock in the morning, and I saw the events unfolding on Twitter. And I said, I just want to go. I want to at least bear witness. So I got in the car, drove 9 hours, ended up in St. Louis. The second night that I was in St. Louis was the first night of the curfew. And it was the first night that I got tear gassed. And it was in that moment that I became a protester.
People from the Arab Spring were tweeting to the protesters in Ferguson how to deal with the tear gas. They were coaching them from Arab Springs to Ferguson, making that connection organically. But I thought, oh, snap, this is different. This is different. They're in solidarity, uprising.
It became clear and undeniable that this was more than a few angry people on the street. Without every single person who was out there tweeting and Facebooking and posting pictures and standing in front of those officers in Ferguson, there would be no movement.
Eric Garner was in New York, Trayvon Martin was in Florida. People think these things don't happen in the Midwest. But now this is, in a sense, the epicenter of a national movement.
I bring to you one of the most influential civil rights leaders of our history, Reverend Al Sharpton. America is time to deal with policing.
We are not the haters, we're the healers. But then let me say this, what does God require? That Michael Brown does not want to be remembered for a riot.
Not at all. Not at all.
Sitting around having ghetto pity parties rather than organizing and strategizing. You've lost where you come from.
You know, there's this idea that this was a space created by these young people, that they'd been in the streets, they'd been tear gas, they had been leading the chants and crafting the signs, and they didn't want older civil rights activists taking what they had created. And I think that that exposed and was one of the first kind of fault lines in what has been a deep ideological split between older Black America and younger Black America.
It was almost like a bat signal had gone off and civil rights had been flashed in the sky, and all of a sudden they rushed like Cape Crusaders to come in and save the day. But this was a very modern movement. People weren't expecting civil rights leaders of a bygone era to stand side by side to these young people who had a voice.
Are you marching today with us, or you just gonna sit in the car?
Because we haven't seen you marching at all, Jesse.
We ain't seen you.
I remember Jesse Jackson showed up and he got yelled down by some of the young activists. This was about defiance. That is the movement.
These protesters took control of the narrative and took it out of the hands of the old guard civil rights establishment. And this was really the first time where people said, no, we're not going to defer to you. We have been successful thus far. So the people of Ferguson are not going away until Darren Wilson, the police officer who shot Mike Brown, is indicted. That is the demand of the movement, is the indictment of Darren Wilson.
We're now talking about what does it mean to have justice? I can remember how different that felt. And it was so tense because we didn't know when the decision was coming.
I think not telling us when the announcement's gonna come is a power play by the state. We are ready though, we've been ready, and we're protesting.
We are about to hear the grand jury decision in the fatal shooting of Michael Brown by Ferguson, Missouri police officer Darren Wilson.
The duty of the grand jury is to separate fact from fiction. They discussed and debated the evidence among themselves before arriving at their collective decision. After their exhaustive review of the evidence, the grand jury deliberated over 2 days, making their final decision. They determined that no probable cause exists to file any charge against Officer Wilson and returned a no true bill on each of the 5 indictments.
We see just the enormity of the problem that the movement is up against, because for every incidence of police brutality that has been exposed, we still have the fact that Darren Wilson, who killed Mike Brown, was not indicted. Every time people have thought the movement disappeared, it reemerges on the streets. It erupted in an entirely new way in the city of Baltimore in April of 2015.
We've heard about so many victims of police brutality before Trayvon Martin died, before Mike Brown died. We know that the system protects police officers, but I don't think it didn't give everyone permission, it gave everyone purpose.
Well-articulated retaliation. This war has only begun. We are being systematically murdered. And it's being televised. We burn with anger and hunger for justice. We've had enough. We will fight back.
There was a fire started. Pray for my dear departed.
Amir Wright!
Why
time I see the chaos and destruction.
Breaking news coming out of New York City where a grand jury has voted not to indict a police officer who used a chokehold on Eric Garner.
Remarkable scene just unfolded moments ago. Half-star LeBron James took the court for warm-ups in this t-shirt bearing the words, "I can't breathe." Latest in a series of pro athletes to invoke those words, which have become a rallying cry for nationwide protests against police brutality.
St. Louis Rams players came out with the hands-up, don't-shoot pose paying tribute to Michael Brown.
It's an artist's duty to reflect the times in which we live, because the struggle for justice is right now. We want to tell you we are with you, we see you, we love you, and march on. God bless you.
Once again in the song, all my life never needed the deepest and strong. Tell me who's gonna score. We just trying to go harder than we did.
Growing outcry tonight after a routine traffic stop that turned deadly. The father, apparently unarmed, shot as he ran from this police officer.
I am sick and tired of being sick and tired. We need to be out here every week, every month, and every year until this changes.
If I hit the jail, I was just passing through. Numbers smudge on my record, y'all had to do.
Look at it! Flag! That boy Lag, look, bro! Go! Flag, broke it, y'all dragging it like
that! For solution, not asking us. So don't stop and ask why we messing up.
No justice in the enemy. There's a fight now for my life now.
25-year-old Freddie Gray died yesterday, just 1 week after he was rushed to the hospital with spinal injuries by four Baltimore police officers. Gray's family attorney says 80% of the man's spinal cord had been severed near his neck. Baltimore police officials are promising accountability.
Go out with my homies, can pay me. I'm angry, I'm hungry for justice. I'm hungry for justice. So angry, it's just us. So angry, it's just us.
Protesters in Baltimore are demanding.
Felt like we was in the civil rights movement. But you know, when I took that image, I didn't think it was gonna end up on the cover of Time. These are not just random acts of riots, and this is anger. This is the uprising, you know, and that's what it is. They're not thugs. They're soldiers, you know, like they're not thugs. These are brothers, these are sisters, these are fathers, these are sons, these are human beings. They're not thugs, they're angry.
Authorities are saying that they want all the protesters off the streets now to prevent a repeat of last night's mayhem, where rioters destroyed 15 buildings, set fire to 150 cars, looted dozens of businesses, and so far there have been over 200 arrests and 20 police officers have in fact been injured. We go right to the ground tonight in Baltimore with the very latest. Our own Geraldo Rivera is there. Geraldo.
We have grown up.
Hey, Sean, it's a very excited crowd where I am standing right now. I'm with the State Senate Majority Leader, Pew. Come on, get out of the way, man. Get out of the way.
Don't touch me.
Well, stop blocking my camera. Stop blocking my camera. You're making a fool of yourself. You're making a fool of yourself.
No, don't walk away. I want you and Fox News to get out of Baltimore City because you're not here reporting about the boarded up homes and the homeless people under MLK. You're not reporting about the poverty levels up and down North Avenue.
I didn't even know who he was. But the first thing I did after that was text my father. I was like, look, I was yelling at someone from the media, so if you see it, don't be mad. When they're reporting about riots, when they're reporting about looting, they aren't reporting about the living conditions or the condition that Penn North was in before the CVS went up into flames.
Everyone can see what's happening. Our villages are broken. So You know, this Freddie Gray story kind of escalated from people waking up into consciousness to people being fed up. You know, Baltimore has been fed up.
I think Baltimore speaks to a deeper problem about policing in American cities. In fact, three of the six police officers that picked up Freddie Gray were African American themselves. If people could say that Ferguson could happen because you had a corrupt white government governing over a mostly black population, Baltimore destroys all of that. And I think we have to take into consideration that inequality gives rise to police violence in black communities. So how do you actually go about fighting for justice?
FTP! Police! FTP! Police! FTP! Police! FTP!
Black Lives Matter.
I think they're a hate group. They hate police officers.
You would think if you have an organized group in America saying we want dead cops, that all decent people would reject that group. You would think, correct?
You know, you're tweeting out that you met the president.
No one prepares you for backlash. Fox News and Bill O'Reilly in particular have come after us. But where did that narrative come from? That's not coming from our mouths. That's not the shared story we have.
You were able to find one clip of some people who were saying some outrageous things, but that is not a reflection of the entire movement.
Mr. Boykin.
Has anybody in the leadership ever said that?
Mr. Boykin, did anybody?
Has Durant McKesson ever said that? Has anyone in the leadership ever said that?
Let's talk about the backlash against Black Lives Matter in some corners of the press. Is it warranted, or is a dangerous connection being made between the movement and a misunderstood message?
Every struggle I've ever been a part of, there are always outliers. There are always occasional folk who show up, who often co-opt or twist the message.
So do you feel that Fox News hosts were seizing on these comments in order to paint with too broad a brush? What do you think happened this week? It seemed like Fox had a narrative
of course they were.
The unfortunate thing is this is the Black Lives Matter movement, which can only be described as nonsense, is creating a lot of this type of thing around the country, and it's going to backfire, quite honestly.
They will do everything they can to make sure that they are top of show hitting you with hard headlines. But we have to anticipate it. We have to stop being surprised, because this is real.
Today, the Harris County Sheriff's Office mourns the loss of one of our own. Deputy Darren Goforth was senselessly struck down while pumping gas at a Chevron station in Northwest Harris County yesterday evening. We've heard Black Lives Matter. Well, cops' lives matter too. So why don't we just drop the qualifier and just say lives matter and take that to the bank?
People are chanting, what do we want dead cops? When do we want them now? I'm not the one saying this. There are people in the Black Lives Matter movement that are saying that we want to go out and we want
to... Are you suggesting that a chant from Minnesota led to the death of an officer?
Not all I'm saying, though, and you heard me talk to Ben and suggest that...
He's accusing an entire group of people for a random act of violence. That without any facts, he's making very, very strong statements, and that is a reason why people protest.
I think what's really important is getting the narrative right. And the narrative from the movement has always been, we are not a movement about harming police. We are a movement about holding police accountable.
What do we do when people act outside of the expectations of who we want to be together? What does it mean for us to be a group? I think in the pursuit of visibility, we can forget what we're fighting for. The glorious and glamorous part is people in the streets and, you know, protesting and all of that. What's not glamorous is figuring out, okay, how do we be together over the long term? How do we learn how to organize?
One of the major difficulties for a truly leaderless movement is this is very much a mosaic of activism. It's bigger, much bigger than any given, you know, quote unquote leader, any given quote unquote organization. And this is the real problem, right?
This is a movement, this is ongoing. We're late, frankly. No matter what we do, we're late. So what's next? Get it together, get informed, become a team.
We all talk about how social media transformed this movement. But now we've seen young protesters without organized leadership. And so there is a question about where the movement goes from here.
The Black Lives Matter movement in my generation, we have to evolve. We have to make sure it doesn't stop, you know, like how other movements did.
2 years ago, hundreds of protesters gathered in Lower Manhattan to occupy Wall Street. But the Occupy movement had its fair share of problems. From protesters' resistance to clear leadership, the movement seems to have faded away.
We come from a long legacy of protest and struggle. But now we have to galvanize. You know, thousands and thousands of people to fight for reforms in their country and in their government. And so that's why we started Black Lives Matter as a network of 39 chapters around the world. We gon' be all right, we gon' be all right. And so the movement is growing. We gon' be all right, do you hear me,
do you feel me, we gon' be all right. Now, Black Lives Matter is a national organization. Supporters disrupt rallies for Democrats and Republicans alike. The tactic has had an impact. The day after activists interrupted Bernie Sanders, he posted a racial justice platform on his website.
We're now talking about what does it mean to be a movement full of people who are leading and doing the work in different ways, and that there is no one way to organize, there's no one way to be in this work?
What people do here is they repeat the problem, you know? And you're like, I get the problem. We know the problem. I don't need another summit about it. Which is why I'm always focused on the concrete stuff.
Awesome. Thanks
good
for
to
your
meet
time.
You.
Yeah, yeah.
So I asked Netta and Brittany and some other people if they wanted to partner, and we created Campaign Zero. Mapping Police Violence was a statement about here are the facts. It is a powerful tool, and we continue to use it to inform our work. When I think about running for mayor, it's about being in a place to change people's lives today and tomorrow. It's about real, concrete things that can happen at the policy level to structurally end police violence.
And that's what's different about this movement. We are seeing leaders come forward. And this is because they took social media and made it work for them. Black Twitter is the matrix. Black Twitter popped it off. And because of Twitter, we know who Patrice is, we know who Alicia is, we know who Netta is. This generation is not gonna let them be nameless. And they're doing that.
So for a movement that's not formally funded, that doesn't have a big headquarters in Washington, D.C., or registered lobbyists, it's a lot of momentum. So where does Black Lives Matter go from here? Well, joining us tonight is Alicia Garza. Thank you for joining us tonight.
You had people who had come from regular backgrounds, who were teachers and students, now became these big personalities. They were on the covers of magazines. They were being interviewed by the New York Times. And in doing so, they were leading a whole generation of Black people, and they were representing them as well.
Careful. Everybody ready?
Yep.
We've got some young people here who are making history as we speak. People like Brittany, who served on our police task force in the wake of Ferguson and has led many of the protests. People like DeRay McKesson, who's done some outstanding work mobilizing in Baltimore around these issues.
It was a real privilege to have the opportunity to be invited to the White House and have a conversation where you are speaking direct truth to power. It is about our children, our community. It is about stay woke. Is that now that you have been exposed, now that you have become aware of issues of police violence in our community, I need you to stay aware. I need you to behave like you're aware, right? I need you to stay woke, get woke, and stay woke.
We can actually change the world if we implement changes on the inside. But also, people need to press from the outside. That pressing from the outside forces things that will otherwise not happen. We need both.
30 African-American football players at the University of Missouri say they're on strike. It is the latest in a series of protests against the school's handling of race relations on campus.
Missouri graduate student Jonathan Butler was so outraged, he went on a hunger strike last week.
How do you feel?
Empowered. Ready to eat.
I am resigning as president of the University of Missouri today, and I take full responsibility for the inaction that has occurred.
People were shocked. And I think that was a seminal moment because it was so dramatic. And there's been a culture shift when it comes to athletes speaking out on social issues.
Every time I step outside, I see my dad.
There is no such thing as the arc of history bending towards justice. People do that.
Is it okay to break the law or not? Because the cops are breaking the law left and right. Like, you don't own us anymore. You see, like, either we all have the same inalienable rights or we don't.
An independent investigation that Mr. Gray's death was a homicide has led us to believe that we have probable cause to file criminal charges.
That's why I'm here. That's why the uprising began. That's why we are still rising to this day.
Today, the Department of Justice is filing a lawsuit in federal district court against the city of Ferguson, Missouri, alleging a pattern and practice of law enforcement conduct that violates the First, the Fourth, and the 14th Amendments of the Constitution and federal civil rights laws.
Really proud of this generation. It's a revolution in a way. They have used this new tool, and I think Black Lives Matter will define this shift in America. I think we will look at Black Lives Matter like we looked at the civil rights movement.
The Black Lives Matter movement is the most important development in Black life in the last 40 years. And the most important aspect of it is that it's ordinary people fighting this fight. It is something that we have been responsible for getting out onto the streets. And I think the movement is here to stay.